It is day 387, 387 days of the Iron Swords War. Today was the national official day of mourning for war losses. Sheri and I were discussing this previously, earlier before the show, that there was an official event with speeches and music and very sad, somber recollections. And in the midst of all of it, we're going through the war in real life. And it was like so few people, I think, were connected to the official mourning event. There was, of course, the IDF Iran attack over Shabbat that we woke up to Saturday morning here in Israel. And I will mention also the Lebanon earthquake that wasn't. That shocked us here in northern Israel, and that my village, Kfar Hanania, I'm reporting from our fortress of solitude here, our safe room. We're famous. I'm on the leaderboard. Our community was noted in a hostile PSYOPs video by Hezbollah as one of the places that we're now on their map to be bombed, as though we weren't before. Many people here have become quite sanguine, is that how you pronounce it? Quite inured to these kind of threats because we're dealing with reality. We don't pay much attention to the PSYOPs noise. It's more for other people abroad, perhaps. Anyway, who do we have here? We've got three people on chat. Okay, you can hear me. If you have any questions for Sheri and myself, please post them. Or speak up. We'd like to hear from you directly, and maybe we'll wait for a few moments. Sheri, are you there? Can we hear you?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, what a relief. Okay. You mentioned that today was an official day of mourning. I didn't feel it at all, aside from seeing a few flags at half-mast. There was no indication that anything was going on. I went to the post office this morning, and in the post office, totally incongruously, one of the post office workers was handing out chocolates to everybody. Not in celebration. He just had he had chocolates, and he went around and he gave them to the other workers, and they had extras, so he decided to give it to us. And I thought, like the people waiting in line, I thought, not today. That's pretty weird. So there wasn't any indication in downtown Haifa that there was anything special about this day. Nothing whatsoever.
You've, we call this Life on the Border, and it originally started out as focusing on the 22, 23 border communities around the Gaza Strip and slightly back from the Gaza Strip. Because of the war now, it's been included the northern border, and Haifa and the whole coast of Israel, let alone areas all around us, it's all one big front at this point. We are fighting a 7+ front war, which is an almost inconceivable sentence to make. How has it been for you, Sheri? You live in an apartment near the port. You're in downtown Haifa. You've been under a lot of stress and rocket attacks as well, drone attacks and God knows what else. And you're also a therapist. How are you coping?
Well, I don't consider that we've been... Yeah, excellent question. First of all, I live right across the street from the Navy training base. So my house is actually a legitimate target because it is right across... It's like I'm... 20 meters, 50 meters at most from the entrance to the base. So of course I hear all the announcements that go on in the base, which is totally confusing because they can have an alert in the base and they don't alert the community. So we are often caught like, what the hell is going on here? And that day of the earthquake, it was very clear the base was calling out earthquake, earthquake, earthquake. So then I'm thinking, what do we do? Do we go outside? Do we go into our safe room?
Lay on the ground. What? Put your hands under your head.
It was totally weird, and there were messages going back and forth in our community WhatsApp group. What the hell are we supposed to do? Thank goodness, very quickly it became clear that it was because of an IDF blasting that in Lebanon of that incredibly huge tunnel that set off the earthquake warning sensors, which was very calming for us. One thing that they could calm us from in this war. And the thing that I think, like I was looking at how I run my day when I was preparing for thinking about this talk we were going to have today. And I live, even though there are places that have had far more warnings and also hits than Haifa. Haifa has pretty much been relatively quiet. Okay. It's north of Haifa and it's east of Haifa that most of the alarms are going off. I consider, well, what am I complaining about? But the thing is, I'm waiting every second of every day for the alarm, for the
Yes,
alert.
we are all
It's
living
always
on. I'm waiting for that. Right, for that. My granddaughter said that every time she hears an alert, because I'm on the security team from our kibbutz, from our village here. It's not a kibbutz. I'm the security team. I have to have my phone on and on me 24/7, including on Sabbaths and holidays where you normally wouldn't do that. And it's not up full loud, it's on low volume, but it's so like jarring and distracting. I wanted to point out to people who are watching from abroad that may not know, there's a difference between hearing an alarm and hearing shoot downs overhead or in the vicinity. The system is so, what's the word I'm looking for? So conforming to large and small communities now. It's been improved since it was first introduced a while back, that we'll have sirens in the nearby communities in the hills right around us, a kilometer, half a kilometer away. That's like a mile and a half away. But it's not affecting us. And we will hear the booms and explosions and the shoot downs of Iron Dome. But if an incoming rocket is going to be aimed ballistically, now the radar can watch this, for an open area, what the army calls an open area, they won't set off a siren. Now that open area may be the other side of your parking lot, but it's open.
Yes.
There's not a building there.
Your windows can rattle when it lands.
Our windows do rattle, and that over the holiday, over Rosh Hashanah, the New Year, Jewish New Year holiday, the 3-day holiday, and Simchat Torah, the real anniversary of October 7th on the Hebrew date, our synagogue had much dancing, our traditional circle dancing, and it was such a relief. And I'll say pleasure, because it was sadder and we were wiser and sadder and pain, because so many of the young men and also women from our village were either in Milouim in reserve duty or as conscripts fighting in various fronts, either in Gaza or the West Bank or in Lebanon. And I wanted to just balance out today's horrific news, as I posted earlier down below in the thread, how terrible today was. And maybe you see it in my eyes. I don't know. Sherry said that I look like I'm really wrecked, and I am a bit.
Exhausted.
I
I said you looked exhausted, totally
I'm
exhausted.
exhausted. I'm exhausted. I think we're all dealing with trauma, right? But mostly what you're seeing in my eyes is the sandstorm that we had here over the last 2 days. And as I mentioned in our pre-conference, our conversation earlier, it was dry as a bone here. So that's what you're seeing in my eyes. But yeah, it's been a really stressful time. But going back to the booms and such, even though it's not in the village itself, the echoes in the hills, and it's a small hilly area where our village is in the central Galilee. It's quite obvious something's going on, and we see the shoot downs, because it's like right overhead. And even though it's not directly overhead and we're not running for cover, it's you know, we do not have a normal life by anybody's standards. And dancing around in our synagogue with the Sefer Torah, with the Torah scrolls, it's a big honor and a joyous moment, even with the pain, even with the grief. And believe me, there's a lot of grief to go around. But the fact that I was dancing with my son and my stepson and my four grandchildren, holding my daughter's 10-year-old grandson, 8-year-old granddaughter, a 2-year-old granddaughter, and a 1-year-old granddaughter at different times, not all at once. You know, the sense that life goes on and that we are supporting each other. There's an old saying that the Torah supports the people that are carrying it, not the other way around. You're not carrying the Torah scroll, it's supporting you. And I could feel that. And I say that not as a religious guy, but just as someone, just the sense of you need to grab onto something and someone else. And, you know, you hold hands like that. Acha Meir, welcome. Hey, Colleen. Hey, Adele. Adele, I want to hear if you can step in for a moment. What's going on with your group that you were, I understand, speaking with today? If we can circle around and come to that. So that's...
With what you were saying, can I cut in for a moment?
Sure.
Because what you were saying, you're talking about the hakafot in the synagogue. And something that seculars who don't go to synagogue don't have. Like
not
me.
Necessarily. There's a lot of seculars that do have
that don't
dancing.
Go.
It's not
the ones
religious
that don't
per se,
go.
But it is a lot of
I'm
celebration.
I'm saying the ones that don't go. Like my family,
okay.
My grandkids don't go. And then you wonder what is the reason, where's the resilience and the hanging on to being part of the Jewish people for people
resilience.
Who do not do anything for the tradition, and yet it's still very strongly there. I can see that in my granddaughter with the questions. She's 11 years old, and the questions that she's asking that show that she has an awareness of the fact that this is a very unique place, in for better and for worse, but a strong attachment.
Sure. Adele, how are you?
Yes, I'm okay. I'm in a center in the old city of Be'er Sheva, Merkaz Tammuz, and I've been asked to come and talk to, I don't know, I'm not sure who's in the audience. I know that it's like with the youth group, but I think there's also soldiers and people who are doing a year's service. So that's supposed to start at 7:30, and I arrived here a bit early, and I'm just waiting in the backstage for it to start. So I thought I'd hop in, see what's going on.
Well, it's great to see you. And I'd like to throw the question out to our viewers, wherever you may be. If you have any questions, please do ask. Don't be shy, and don't worry that your question is out of place or something. We're Israeli. We don't deal with political correctness.
I assume you explained that this is a national day of mourning.
Yes,
I did.
That's what I opened with.
I'm not quite sure why we need another national day of mourning in addition to
Bingo.
October 7th, in addition to Simchat Torah. But I was asked this morning to speak on a Zoom to a school up north, Kfar Vradim.
Mm.
So these are also kids who are not going to school because their schools are in rocket range, and they're doing their schooling on Zoom. And I was asked to address them, so I did that for an hour and a half this morning, which was very, and they had great questions. It's such sweet questions. What's the first thing you're going to do when you go home? And like stuff like I've never, you know, questions I've never gotten before. And then this afternoon I was interviewed on a radio program on Reshet Bet, on one of the radio stations here, because on October 7th,
Okay, the fun has started.
That's not me, that's by you, hey?
That's by that's by us. Go on.
On October 7th, I was interviewed from my safe room by the same person who interviewed me today. And we were
keep
getting
talking.
Those sounds.
Come a little, I'm trying to lower it, but you keep speaking. Come a little closer.
Okay.
You want to
well,
hear
I'm
it?
On my, yeah, so they interviewed me on October 7th from my safe room. I was lying down on my stomach, on my bed, so that I could whisper into the phone. And I was telling them, we're hearing Arabic outside. And that was what they had on the recording from October 7th. So they played the recording from October 7th today, and I spoke to them again today about you know,
how was it
doing
for Adele? How was it for you to hear that recording?
Yeah,
it must have been very. I can't even imagine it.
It was a lot harder living it at the time. Now I know that I'm okay. When I was doing that recording, I didn't know if I was going to be okay or not.
Wow.
So, it was, so it's been a heavy day. And again, I'm not quite sure what for, but anytime I'm asked to come talk, I never say no.
Right.
So I didn't say no again 3 times today. One more left, and a few minutes we'll be going on stage, and that's it. That's our lives here, and we got to talk, and we got to tell, and we got to.
Where do you get your energy from, Adele? I don't get it. Where do you get that?
I was in America for three weeks, nonstop traveling.
I've got this battery in the back, like a battery pack here that you just open up, like there's a little
Tony
door.
Like Tony Stark in the Avengers, right? The power thing.
No, the energy bunny.
I know that I don't experience a half of what some other people in the country are going through. And yet I know that my mind fogs over. Sometimes it freezes so I can't think. I sometimes will get tired when I shouldn't be tired. So I can't imagine what it's like for you.
Do what you got to do.
That's easier said than done for a lot of people. I mean, I understand you're going to jump out in a few minutes, but, you know, props, because you've been, Valerie, I have to quote this. I'm sorry for being so scatterbrained here. This is me, by the way, in wartime. This is me totally scatterbrained. For me to like write something on Substack and then post it on Facebook on Live on the Border or vice versa, it's like a supreme effort to keep my thoughts straight. And I know it shows. I know it sounds like that too. I'm not usually like this. I was once young and I could raise, you know, lift cars over my head for a living. Anyway, Valerie says something sweet. I'm not religious, but when you read the scriptures, I can hear the alarm. You cannot get away from the fact that God keeps you and always has from the beginning. With that said, it cannot be easy with all those fallen people and young soldiers. You have no idea. Well, you do have an idea. But we just lost, Sheri, what were you saying when we spoke earlier? In the last 10
last
days?
Last week, it was 23 people last week.
23 soldiers. Last week, one, if not two people in an Arab village, the Hezbollah doesn't care, Jews, Arabs, they don't care. They just want to kill. That were killed by falling rockets. Someone in the village of Tamra in another rocket attack today. This is all happening today. Were killed in the Arab village of Tamra. It's a large, famous Israeli Arab town. Sheri lives in a mixed city, Haifa, Akko, it's 50-30, 30-60, 60-40.
We're around there.
You have to understand, it's not just the Jews that are being singled out. It's the Zionist entity. It is the battle.
But don't you remember, do you remember the last war with Lebanon, when there was a kid, about a 10-year-old kid, that was killed by a rocket in Nazareth, an Arab kid, and Nasrallah claimed him as a shaheed?
No, I don't, but I believe it. Saying he's a shaheed, in other words, he was a holy martyr for the cause. So it was okay to blow him apart because he's a holy martyr for the greater Islamic supremacist cause. Got any new jokes we haven't heard before? Yeah. Right. Any questions from anyone here? I want to toss one out to Adele, to anybody else. Rob, how you doing? What you got? Adele's going to have to jump off. She's got a group coming, and she's nervously checking
her phone. Well, you can't hear me. I was just going to. I was just going to say, I'm not used to using this, the Zoom on my phone. I'm very spoiled. Just doing it on the computer.
It's very crowded.
So when I got here to the event, I asked them if they know how many people are coming. And they said, well, they don't know, but they know that very often, because there was a terrorist attack today, there might be people that aren't sending their kids. Now, the last time I was supposed to have given this talk on October 6th, that was the plan. And it was canceled because there was a terrorist attack in Beersheba. So they canceled it. And like, I was able to understand that, but this is our country. We're in a country in trauma, and Beersheba is 2 hours away from where, a 2-hour drive away from where the terrorist attack happened today. Yeah. But it's a country in trauma, and parents aren't letting their kids go out at the drop of a hat, and people aren't letting their kids go to school at the drop of a hat.
That's happening all over the north. Our neighbors, who both of them are educators, and are my close friend, who's lost his brother on Kibbutz Kfar Aza. He was the chief of security on Kfar Aza. He was killed in a heroic firefight. They're both educators. They said they can't understand the logic of the education ministry, whether to have kids go back, whether or not. I posted on the group a picture of a bus with notes from the home front command telling what kids should do if they're on a bus in a rocket attack. And I wrote sarcastically, cynically, and how was your day for kids going to school? You know, this is like a normative reality, as they say in Hebrew slang, lenaumel, to normalize something that is totally batshy crazy bizarre.
Thinking about kids, it's very hard to see. You know, just a few years ago, our kids were at home for how long because of Corona?
Yeah.
And now there are kids that are at home for a year doing their classes in elementary school on Zoom. It's and when there is school here in Haifa, whereas my granddaughter used to take my younger brother, they would go by themselves up to school by bus. Well, of course, they don't do that anymore. They have to be driven to school, picked up. They've lost the independence that they were developing.
Kids are very independent, very. We don't have helicopter parents in this country. Forget that. Yeah.
Just helicopters.
She's good. She's here all week, two shows a night. Okay, now I'm getting a call that I don't need right now. Okay. Sorry, everybody. Sorry for that. Colleen Hoover asks, it's okay, Dave, thank you. And do you appreciate the efforts? Do you think Israel will continue to attack Iran? Yeah. This is all of us. Come on, Sheri, you do it too. Everybody does. We don't know.
Who asked that? Colleen asked that? So, like, we could tell you, but then we'd have to kill you.
Yeah, that's what I said. That's my line. I write that on Facebook, and Facebook blocks me. So verbally, we can get away with it.
Zoom's not scared of me.
Many people feel that it's good what Israel did, because we got strategic and tactical targets and walked between the raindrops with the U.S. government and the Biden-Harris campaign to try and re-win the election. I find it hard to believe that that is the end of it. Iran says they will respond. I don't know what that means. They're canny like that. They're not stupid. They may go through for Jewish or Israeli targets anywhere in the world, right? There was a hot morning just the other day in Sri Lanka, the middle of, you know, heaven on earth, somewhere in the Pacific, Sri Lanka, going to kill Jews. So that's the answer. I think and I hope Israel will go after the nuclear facilities and with other countries, maybe go for a strike to hit the head of the snake. But that's just wishful thinking. Look, we're just folks like you, literally. I'm sorry, Colleen. Just like you, we're not unique like that. We're just regular folks. I used to be a reporter, true. I'm not hooked in the way I was, you know, through veins and arteries to sources. But I have a lot of information and awareness, and I've been in the IDF and stuff. But we're doing the best we can as regular citizens, really just like you. We have no...
Dave, you can tell them the truth.
Say what?
You can tell them the truth. You can tell them the truth. We have chips. We all have chips inserted in us.
Okay.
And Blabbermouth. I'm not joking. This is...
Blabbermouth, Adele.
When there were hostages that came back from Gaza that told us that in interviews, they spoke about how when they got there, they were examined. They were made to go into the shower and their bodies were examined for chips. Oh. Because everybody, they were told, the Gazans who were holding them were told that all Israelis have chips. So Ada Sagi, who was one of the hostages from Niroz when she was released, she told about how they made her go into the shower and she wouldn't agree with the man. So he sent his wife in and she examined her body and every little birthmark she checked and she asked, what's that and what's that? And they were looking for the chips.
They're on to us. The Jewish space lasers. Oh God. All right. Sorry for the black humor, for the dark gallows humor, whatever you want to call it, guys. You know.
I'm just, apologize. That is one of our strengths.
That and Arak. I'm telling you. Adele is 7:30 and Adele I think has had to jump off just now. Hi, Holly Boker. We haven't had
I'm gonna go. Good to see everybody. Thank you everybody for coming.
Enjoy. This is Sage. We are house sitting. Over the holiday, we had over the Simchat Torah holiday, we had six adults, two dogs, four cats, and one bathroom. And we're troopers here. And it was great, but boy, we had some moments, and when the alarms go off, I'm telling you, when your 8 and 10-year-olds say, you know, Saba, Grandpa, should we go in the miklat? You know, it rings different. You know, it hits differently than when you're just dancing with the Sefer Torah. But there was I wanted to say that for people who just came in later, the sense that we did dance. And that's the hashtag that's been shared around quite a bit. We will dance again. We did dance again. We will dance again, despite everything, with all the pain. Wiser, sadder, smarter, and a hell of a lot more experienced in dealing with this stuff. In a way.
And more cynical. More cynical as well.
More cynical? Okay, more cynical, but that's where the good jokes come from. Where do you think I get my memes from? I'm the one who shares all the memes. Anyway, so this is astounding, Adele. Had no idea that what? About the chips, Rob? Yeah. Guys, you don't know.
I wanted to I'm going to take the opportunity here to say something from my professional background. I used to be a sex trauma therapist, working with for about 25, 30 years with families who had experienced sexual trauma and individuals. And what is amazing to see in this country now is everybody, all the professionals coming together to offer their expertise for all those, our entire country is suffering from some degree of psychological trauma, whether it's directly having been affected or secondary trauma, meaning just reading the news and knowing that the news is something that happens 5 kilometers from you or next door is also enough to traumatize so many of us. And so a lot of therapists getting together to offer their expertise to help their fellow citizens, and also organizations from the United States, for example, I know of a few who have set up particular NGOs to bring over experts to come and help to supplement the professionals here so that we can actually take care of everybody.
You know, I want to ask you about that since we're talking about that briefly. There was a recent article in Tablet magazine that I sent to you, I shared with you, and we discussed behind the scenes, of psychotherapist international groups, North American groups, Canada and the US, whatever, what have you, that were essentially silencing and canceling anyone Jewish and Israeli. Tell me about your feelings about that professionally. That must be like, I don't know, you like having a tape slapped on your mouth.
Well, I don't know that that affects me any differently than all of the rest of the academic hamstringing of us and shutting our face, forcing, like shutting us down. That doesn't, that's no more. It's a, that's an added, I can say that it adds to my trauma, to my stress. And to the degree of stress that I feel, because everywhere I look outside the country, I see how we're being lied about and news isn't getting out the way it should, because just like some people here made comments that they don't get this kind of information on their news stations outside of Israel, people don't understand, they don't have the context. And so they say we're committing genocide, we're doing this, we're killing children, it's horrible. So that adds to the stresses that we're feeling. It has nothing to do with whether they're therapists or historians or just run of the mill people in the street.
Right.
Yes.
How does it feel, Valerie asked, when most of the world leaders are saying about a two-state solution, how could they impose it on Israel? Honestly, that's like higher level stuff we're like dealing with. I want to make it to the bomb shelter safely without tripping and face planting. I mean, we're dealing with like daily life, and that's what life in the border is all about, our daily lives, not the highfalutin stuff is going on. Honestly,
you know how
they say what they want. Jump in. Yeah, you were saying.
It makes me furious. I do relate to it. And it makes me absolutely furious. How dare they, to quote from, what's her name, that awful kid from Sweden who on climate thing, how dare you? That's exactly how dare you.
Take my childhood. Yes.
What gives me hope is the fact that the last time they brought it to the Knesset, an overwhelming no came from the Knesset, including opposition parties. So that gives me hope.
Okay. Any other questions? Holly, you are asking, hang on, Sunny Lexington, thank you for checking in from Lexington. Home, bring home the hostages, walk, okay. Tell me something, you do that walk. I'm honestly asking as a regular Israeli on the street, I'm not asking like accusatorily, what good does it do? How does it energize people when you have that kind of walk? Briefly, because time is tight.
You're not the only one who asks that question, but
I mean it in a good way.
Yeah, I think that it helps us to feel like we're supporting Israel and supporting the idea of the hostages, you know, needing to get home soon, identifying with people who we have in Israel. Like I said, Carmit joined us last week. She's from Nero's, and she articulated that it really means a lot to the hostage families that people are remembering that the hostages are still not home all over the world and doing these weekly marches. So even if it's just that, then it's enough.
Okay. Okay. So you're keeping the flame alive. We live with it every moment of every day. And again, my question was on the good side. It was meant in constructively, not critically. This is maybe Dave personally speaking, we feel a sense that we've been abandoned in the world stage. And I know folks like you and everybody else on this group and other people around the world are foursquare strongly supporting us. Tough time though. And we've got less than 1 minute and it may blank out. So I want to thank everyone, Sheri Oz and Adele and all of our guests and friends that were here that spoke up and